All right. Welcome to the January 9th, 2017 Budget Committee meeting. I would like to open, call the meeting to order with the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, attendance-wise, we have everyone present, and then we have pretty much the entire school board and then some. Right? I think, okay. Tonight, what we're going to do is we're going to go through work session. We're going to go through the proposed warrant articles for the school. But before we do that, I just want to take care of old business and approve the minutes from both the, well, I messed up on the agenda. The 12th, and we had November 28th, December 5th, right?
Yep.
Actually, we just have the 12th that we have to do. Never mind. December 12th. So can I have a motion to accept the minute meetings for December 12th, 2016?
So moved.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Jinx. Any revisions? Okay. I don't have anything either. It was fairly short and sweet. Okay, so for can I then, for all those in favor of the accepting the minutes as written, can I get an aye?
Aye.
Aye.
And we should not have any abstentions, correct?
I think I was out of town on the 12th.
I have you listed.
I forget when I was out.
Yeah,
I was out for a week. 1 week then. I missed a meeting.
Okay.
Does that mean we need to amend it?
Yeah. I have to go back and look, but I may have to amend that. Okay. All right, so what we have on our docket then tonight is we went over the school budget the last time on the 5th, and tonight is really more so about, there only is only four warrant articles, so really it's warrant article number two, to spend some time going through the facilities bond warrant article number two. So, Superintendent Nato, floor is yours.
So thank you. There are members of the school board here, as you acknowledge, as well as some members of the facilities committee, and all of them will be available to answer questions should you have any. As you know, the school board is proposing a bond in the amount of about just under $39 million for the upcoming year to address the following needs at the elementary and junior senior high school. The facilities committee was established with goals to look towards a bond in March of 2017. They've been working for about 18 months to meet the long-term needs of those schools with a plan that's educationally and fiscally responsible, complies with the New Hampshire Department of Education standards, meets the requirements under the American Disabilities Act, is flexible, and is, works for a 21st century learning environment. And there have been a number of public sessions held through the fall, and all of their public meetings are archived and online on the facility's website, but there's been a great deal of effort put out to engage the public through this process, and here we are. I won't walk you through all of these dates, but again, this has been going on for about 18 months. At the elementary school, many of you have had the opportunity to tour the facility, I know, but one of the challenges is that we have 4 fifth grades, as well as a variety of special service programs that are currently housed in the modular classrooms. They are detached from the school at the rear of the building. One of those buildings was replaced in recent years after its predecessor was condemned. We continue to have significant maintenance and upkeep associated with these buildings. The roof of one was recently replaced, and those are the types of challenges that will continue to exist with modulars. Again, if you've been inside, you know that we also face some challenges with crowded instructional spaces and certainly a lack of storage, which is most evident during the winter months, if you have the opportunity to walk through. Our nurse's office is really not adequate to meet the needs of the population that she is serving today. As there is not adequate storage space, much of her equipment is stored in what used to be a shower area. And when you are serving students in the 21st century, you are serving students with a variety of health and medical issues. We service children from preschool through fifth grade. Some of those students require diapering and toileting services. We have students who require feeding tubes, and we're doing that in a very tight space without a lot of privacy, which is not particularly sanitary or environmentally, it's not best practice. I'll leave it at that. In our administrative office, our assistant principal does not have a private office. She functions kind of behind the holding position. A little cubicle in the corner, which again doesn't provide what you would hope for privacy for students or parents who may have needs to meet with her. In our cafeteria, aside from the fact that we use it frequently for instruction, because we don't have those adequate instructional spaces for some of our special education and intervention programs, we also don't have really any sound separation between the music room and the cafeteria itself. In the cafeteria, we serve lunch from about 10:45 in the morning until about 1:15 in the afternoon. For students who are in school from about 8:30 till 3 p.m. And again, that can be a very long time without food for young people kind of on either end of that time frame. Our gym is undersized according to state regulations. It's about half the size of what a fully functional gym space should be for current program needs. The other thing you notice if you enter into the elementary school is that we don't have a secure main entrance. So while we do have a buzzer system, meaning that someone has to let you into the building when school is in session, you can enter through those doors and go directly into the cafeteria or gym area, or turn right or left into the hallway as the doors don't enter into the main office, allowing us to sort of best keep the school safe. The proposal for the elementary school includes a new full-size gym, updated and expanded kitchen, classrooms, again, eliminating the need for modular classrooms, mechanical, electrical, and plumbing upgrades. Those systems all date to the when the school was built in the 1986-87 era. Expanded sprinkler coverage so that we're consistent with fire codes. Again, addressing those security needs. And the final pieces are really some of those site work pieces, but we have significant parking needs, as you may know if you've visited the facility, for any event, as well as a real challenge with parent and bus drop-off co-mingling. We see that in the morning and afternoon. Today, traffic was backed up a good distance on the 152. More people dropping off their children in cold weather, but it presents some real safety challenges for us. That's the existing site plan. And there are large-scale versions over here that are with us tonight if you need to take a look at those before or after, and we'll leave them in this space for you. The proposal shows the two additions in orange. You can see at the rear of the building. So the front of the building is facing the parking lot area. We're showing an additional, right here. Since you can't see what's behind you. Bam. So here, in orange, we show the two additions to the building. Here in the back, we're showing the gymnasium addition. And over here is where you'll see the additional classrooms for the fifth grade, as well as what we're calling a flex space that allows us to take up space for those years when we might have what we call bubble classes, 100 students in a grade level, as opposed to our normal sort of mid-80s. And then we're showing the expanded parking area here and a bus loop that comes in through what is now the McGrath property and exits out onto Grant Road. The intent will be, and this is all pending future traffic studies and DOE permit approvals should the bond pass, but parent traffic entering off of 152, essentially a one-way loop in and out. There may be more. This is the existing elementary school. And you can see in this next drawing, the shaded areas represent the additions that we just discussed. Visual number two. again, you see the gymnasium area along most of this expanded kitchen area. What is currently both the cafeteria and gymnasium becomes one full-size cafeteria with a hallway taking up this last area to connect through to the gymnasium and what will be the bus drop-off entrance in the rear. Over here, you see the fifth grade classrooms, an additional preschool classroom. Right now we service about 30 students as required under special education law. We service children in grades 3 to 5. Best practice for preschool programs is a 50-50 match with typical peers. So parents pay tuition to have their children be the typical peers in that classroom, which offsets our program costs. And you see in green that we're also adding in some special education and intervention spaces. So service math and reading intervention, special education, English language learner programs. In the main office and nurse's office areas up here, those are shown in brown. They're undergoing some renovations, what they would consider light to medium renovations to reconfigure the walls there to allow for assistant principal's office, conference space, conference room space. And again, in special education, we're reconfiguring a couple of areas here to allow for some private instructional space so that we're no longer using the cafeteria. Should have just brought all of these. That'll be a lesson for the next one. Here you see, and we'll bring that one over. Here you see the proposed entrance at the rear of the school, at the top. So again, buses would drop off from behind the school, separated from the parent pick up the drop-off traffic. And then you see the proposed additions, again, in the back corners of the building, one more drawing. We'll get to costs in a bit, but any questions about the elementary school thus far?
Do both the back and front have secure entrances?
They do. So there, in the back, there would be a double vestibule. With again, a buzzer entry system. It will also be our delivery entrance.
Is that also something that if they were to have functions in the cafeteria and gym where they can close off the rest of the school so they can just go through that?
That is correct. That additional hallway that we're adding allows us to kind of close off this back area and have this area open as an entrance for public functions. Usually we just have in the gym and cafeteria.
Further to your question about the secure entrances, we're lucky now to have Wayne Stevens as our school resource officer. He's got a lot of letters after his title. I don't know if they need one or two in the state. We go for some other districts, ask Wayne how to structure these things.
Okay.
So Lee's not only looking, we'll be looking at that and working with our architect on that, but everything to do really with both schools.
No problem. Just a point of clarification. You may have already answered this in past meetings, and I might have missed it. But with these additions and renovations, will any sections of this newly renovated building, would you be able to build up on it versus what we're currently able to do with the building?
So the answer is not without additional work.
Okay.
You'd have to put in footings, and that wasn't recommended at this time. It's just not prudent to do that if you're not envisioning that need, but they could be added in the future if
okay.
You have a different answer to that.
No, we didn't add actually more classrooms on the ground level.
Kind of see where they might go on these drawings.
Yeah.
The other aspect, too, is that although it's mostly ledge, you see where that yellow school bus is behind the school in the drawing on the screen. You recall from a Warren article this past year, there'd be a land swap. There's 4 acres back there that we're acquiring. So if the economies should be such that we would need to use that land, you'd have to do some blasting or whatever.
Yeah.
At least it's there.
Yeah.
That was an important point along with the McGrath property.
I will add that one consideration at the elementary school level is that you can't have students below second grade on the second floor.
Sure.
For their primary classroom, so there'd have to be some reconfiguration to accommodate that as well.
Thank you.
Junior, senior high school. again, we have a challenge with the security of our main entrance, and that our main entrance is actually physically on the side of the building, not connected to the main office. So again, while we have a buzzer and camera system in place, someone can easily come in through those doors, and if someone isn't actively monitoring or quick to get to them, they can turn into the hallways and go anywhere in the building essentially. That entrance is also a challenge because it's where our deliveries occur. It's not only our main entrance for students and bus and parent drop-off, but it's also where the dumpster is serviced and where all of our deliveries come into the building. Again, I know that most of you have been into the building at different points. The oldest part of the building, which is what you're looking at in this drawing, dates to the 1920s. Hallways were not built to the same specs that they are today. It is crowded at times that students are moving through those hallways. Similar challenges with storage space as a junior, senior high. We have taken advantage of whatever real estate was available. So that means the showers in some cases, and you can see the top photo is our music and band room. And then that encompasses instrument storage and choral music storage and the pianos in there and a couple of whiteboards and there's a lot. Music stands and the stage. The top photo shows our instructional technology laboratory. It is, again, crowded for the level of equipment that we'd like to be able to use, which limits our ability to have a large number of students participating in those classrooms at any given time. We have an excellent instructor, and she does a great job of kind of working through stations, but it isn't the ideal setup and the ideal space for programs today. And again, you can see the middle school classroom in the lower photograph, which is smaller than what regulations currently would require. Again, the kitchen has equipment that dates back to when that part was added on in the 60s, so we have some 50-year-old equipment in there. Again, my term is vintage. You haven't heard me use that, but we have some vintage equipment. Again, the exterior cooler, because there's not space within the existing kitchen, is located outside, so our staff go outside to the freezer to bring food in. To prepare it for the day. It's not ideal in that it increases the wear and tear on your freezer as well. Again, no real storage. There's my word vintage. This is our heating ventilation equipment. That's our existing boiler room. It doesn't meet current code, and that building itself will be a teardown. It really is not in good condition. That equipment, as well as our electrical systems, are at the end of their useful life. Electrical distribution, as it notes there at the end, is not consolidated. We have, I believe, 4 electrical panels distributed throughout the building in different areas, which again makes any work that you're trying to do upgrades there more challenging. Renovations for the junior senior high include additions to encompass the programs that exist within the building, but to provide them with adequate spaces. Renovations to some of the existing classrooms to bring them into compliance with the Department of Education regulations. Insulation for this building, the shell of which, again, large parts date to the 1920s, as well as 50s and 60s. New mechanical, electrical, and fire systems. Again, improved parking we're proposing in this drawing. You're good.
Carpenter land.
Might as well bring them home. So we're proposing in this drawing that faculty parking will move across the street, leaving student parking here on the existing site. The intent was to not have students have to cross, but we're also putting in a bus loop around the front of the building, which is where the main entrance will be located, to again separate that parent drop-off and bus traffic. Okay, moving along. Existing building, first thing that you see is the first floor of the existing building, and the second floor of the existing building. The gym area is shown there at the rear. That is not proposed to be touched, nor is the elevator and the stairwells that were renovated a couple of years ago for your fire and life safety needs. this is the proposed rendering of the first floor. Again, you can see additions here in glass on both sides. Essentially, the best way to do this without having to move most of the site utilities is to kind of wrap the building, and it's a tight site, so we're working in close proximity to the existing building as possible. On this side is where the middle school classrooms will be added, as well as a music addition here. You're seeing a courtyard, essentially, in order to get a layout that is reasonable, where stairwells and hallways aren't crisscrossing. The easiest way to do that was to leave a little bit of open space. That open space will, of course, be brick walls all the way around it, but just an open courtyard, which also brings natural light into the classrooms that surround that, which otherwise wouldn't have been available.
Now, that's the space right by the door right now.
This is right by the main entrance.
Yeah, right by the entrance. Yeah. Cafeteria and everything. Okay.
Yeah. And the second floor, which again, you can see the two-story additions encompass this corner over here, where the science classrooms will be. And as well as this area here where the middle school classroom is. So here again, you've got middle school classrooms, separated middle school and high school bathrooms in the proposal. We keep the existing bathrooms that are in the center of the building and add additional bathrooms for the middle school, which is also a code compliance issue. Here are the drawings. So you see the new main entrance in the top photo facing 152. And you can see in the lower drawing there where the bus loop would be in front of the building. And then the side entrance around the back here, the gymnasium area, and the arts and music area. Giving you again, as Mr. Foltz raised earlier, the ability to shut down different parts of the building to access those core spaces.
The courtyard, so it's really a technical reason we have the courtyard versus just cosmetic alone. Can you reiterate again? It was so stairwells won't crisscross, or?
It's essentially to put on the most efficient configuration for the building. So it also gives the added benefit of bringing in natural light. If you didn't have that, you're going to have a couple of center classrooms that are essentially boxed in rooms with no exterior light. And not easy passes through those.
And I remember a meeting, I thought, when you guys were discussing if you filled it in, it was actually going to cost more to try to configure that area rather than just leave it as is.
That's correct. One of the cost-cutting opportunities we looked at as we went back through these drawings second and third time was to see, could we potentially use that space, potentially keep some of the science classrooms? There were added costs to do that. It didn't really save in the long run. And there were program impacts that the facilities committee didn't find out.
It's not just the open courtyard, it would be like an outdoor classroom. Back when we visited Portsmouth Middle School, that you were building in fall, they had one. It's a really well-used space.
Yeah, it's
it's adjacent to the their cafetorium in Portsmouth. They use it, throughout the year.
Right.
And so in our case, it's adjacent to our art classrooms, our library, media center, and across the hallway from the gymnasium.
Okay. Any other questions? Phasing.
So I'll relatively quickly walk through the phasing piece. It is fairly complex. Both of these projects are proposed to occur, to overlap. The elementary school is shown here, and you can see the existing building with the overlay of the proposed additions. The elementary school project is projected to begin in June of 2018 and wrap up in July of 2019. Most of the initial work is putting in what will eventually become the bus loop increasing the parking area, the what will become the buses will be the construction entrance for that year. We have to relocate the modular buildings, which is not an insignificant expense, but in order to maintain our existing program while the additions are being constructed, we're going to still need to make use of those buildings, and so they will move onto the McGrath, what is now, again, now the McGrath property during the construction piece, and will be separated. You can see on the drawing that's shown kind of a red crisscross line. That's essentially where the construction fencing will be to separate the construction site from the existing school program. Again, first summer, parking, bus loop, putting up the shells of the additions, and some minimal interior renovations, depending on how things are progressing at the front office area.
Can I ask a quick question?
Absolutely, go ahead, Tony.
How will you handle security with the temporary classrooms over on the McGrath property?
So they're already detached from the building. Essentially, there's going to be, you can see in green or light green there, where there'll be a walkway specific for those class, specifically to those classrooms. We have security cameras already in place. We have a buzzer system at the entrances for those buildings, so they are locked during the day. That has key to access to be able to get into those buildings. And again, the perimeter construction fencing is going to separate the construction area from the school site, including the modulars.
I hate to ask this, but since we had to redo a roof, do we think the modulars will be able to get us through the construction period?
That is our impression, based on our conversations with the company that maintains them for us and furnished us.
Somewhat related question. We're confident they're going to survive the move. They're good structural integrity to them.
Again, we had the modular company come and take a look at them and assess that for us, and they seemed confident that they would be able to move them.
Go ahead.
Jeff.
Does that company do the move, or does the...
They do, in fact. They will do the move.
We just purchased one of them. How many more games do we have?
Two after this year. I believe that we're in year 3 of 5.
And then we'll move them up to high school?
Potentially. We'll show you that in just a couple
of minutes. Question was the McGrath property, the demolition of the buildings in that, is that included in the site work?
It is.
In this? Okay.
It is. And that may or may not be how it plays out, but those numbers are included.
They're included. Okay.
Again, during the school year, essentially what will happen at the elementary school is that they'll be working to construct those additions in the back with the goal of finishing those at the end of the school year so that we'll be able to occupy them. Then they'll finish the renovations to the interior spaces, and we'll relocate the temporary classrooms. One thing I didn't point out, but you can see it on the edge here where the number 4 is. So Pond Street runs right along the edge of the McGrath property, and we've held a couple of neighborhood meetings with folks who abut the elementary property. One of their concerns, understandably, was the concern about having a bus driveway run through the McGrath property, which right now is some older buildings that have been there for quite a long time, and field space. The bus loop is proposed to run through the center of that property, so essentially equal amount of footage on both sides, and then we talked to the neighbors about fencing and landscape screening, so shrubs, bushes that will serve a purpose to block both the noise and the light.
Does that still need to go in front of the zoning board?
It will, yeah. That's another step, zoning, planning, permitting, a lot left if the bond passes. Again, finishing those final interior spaces, the most significant of which is that existing gym and cafeteria that put in that hallway and expand the rest of the kitchen there. The junior senior high project is a bit more complex and is projected to begin in April of 2018. Again, starting initially with some site work, and I'll describe some of what that entails. Then the core and classroom renovations during that first summer, and then we project that it won't wrap up until the winter of 2020, so a little under 2 years of construction.
Is it the
understand why we wouldn't start until April. And quickly go over that, but it's the drawings we see here are really high-level drawings. They're not even close to construction drawings. It would be after the bond is approved in March this year that the architects would really drill down and make construction drawings, which takes, you know, several months, the whole summer and probably into the fall. And by that time, you don't typically begin construction once the ground freezes unless you have to. So, and it's a better time in the winter to bid out the stuff, generally speaking. Contractors are typically will give their best prices in the winter when they're slow. And then you would break ground that following spring in April. So that's why there's that time period.
Yeah, and as Mr. Foster pointed out, there's that permitting and approval process as well that still needs to happen, some of which can't happen until more detailed level drawings are complete. So again, starts with the parking lot of the Carpenter for the parking lot of the Carpenter property. Again, because there's so much work that needs to happen on site, we would need that parking area available when the school year started. Included relocating the storage building and constructing a new boiler room. We anticipate during that first year that we will have a temporary boiler hookup. You'll see that referred to a little bit later in your slides if you haven't had a chance to read through them yet. But we'll finish up that parking lot, put in the new main entrance and drop off booth. One of the site challenges that we face is the location of the existing sewer line. It's shown on that slide in green. It comes in off of 152, runs very close to the edge of the building and directly behind it. I have said, and we'll say here, that we have some challenges with that subject line from time to time. I got a chuckle from the high school faculty when I mentioned it today, but there's truth to the statement that there are times when the building smells like a wastewater treatment plant. Again, not an ideal learning environment. So in order to fit in the additions, though, we need to relocate that sewer line. So the relocation is shown in red. And then there's a little bit of demo that happens where that number six is, and the media saturation was put on in the be adding the boiler room shell, putting in the new foundations, making the connections to the boiler room. Again, we'll need a temporary boiler trailer. We anticipate during that first winter, we won't have finished the construction of that adequately, so we'll hopefully get through getting that boiler room up and running before the heating season is over with any luck, and we'll finish constructing the additions, the spaces that are fully occupied the following year. Again, we'll be working just in the additions during that first school year, so there will be kind of temporary walls in place so that you can't connect from one to the other. So during the next summer, we have to make those physical connections from the new additions to the existing building. We'll move program into those new spaces and begin the renovation of the core spaces. Core spaces refer to your cafeteria, library, media center, gymnasium. So it says there, convert existing cafeteria kitchen to the new media center.
It's nothing bad. I'm just wondering if you would like a mic on the table. I'm sorry for interrupting.
If you can't hear me, I'm happy to.
I think it's having a lot, the door sounds really loud and stuff like that. So I'll.
I can stand. While you work on it, I'll stand. There'd be some work to the second floor additions. We'll see if this works. Some work on the second floor. So begin the renovations there during that first summer. If you're familiar with the building or have had a chance to read through the various reports, you know that we still have asbestos in parts of the 1920s era building. And so that asbestos would be removed and updated as part of this project. And the installation of new bathrooms. And then, during that second school year, we'll be actually doing work to renovate the interior part of the building while school is in session. And that's where the potential need to reuse those modulars the second year. Once we finish at the elementary school, at this point, we anticipate that we would move them to the junior senior high school for use during that second year.
Where would those modulars roughly be placed?
Carpenter, probably.
Do we know, like, what classrooms is it? Is it the second floor? Is that what I'm looking at? Or
well,
is that...
so during that fall and winter, we have some first floor renovations and second floor renovations to complete. So it's possible that our goal is to minimize the change in the educational program. I can't tell you today exactly what that will look like, but I can imagine we're going to be having weekly meetings to shape these things up, and our goal is to minimize what needs to
disruption.
So, and limit how frequently students have to cross the street. So there'll be a lot of thought given to the best way to organize that.
One of the keys there, Dave, is the new stuff will be brought online, so there'll be, you know,
right,
that available in
yeah.
addition to the modulars.
Total cost for the project, the elementary school is $10.5 million, and the junior senior high school is $28.4 million. Again, bringing that total bond request to $38,943,003. At the elementary school, of those $10.5 million, about $1.5 million is the site work cost. About $7 million in just the straight construction costs for the additions and the renovations that are proposed. $1.28 million are owner project costs, which are detailed in another slide coming up, and a $426,000 contingency. Escalation costs refer to what we know, sort of the annual
cost
of
construction
materials. This piece is the construction cost breakdown, so you can see it's broken out by new construction, 22,000 square feet, and the medium and light renovations that we highlighted in the interior part of the existing building, about 10,000, 11,000 square feet. Again, breaking down, you can see that there's a limited amount for landscaping allowance. Not included here is the cost to remove and replace the oil tank. Again, because we know as a district that that's something we're going to need to address this spring. We're working with the engineers who currently service and maintain our tank to connect with the engineers who are working on this project should it pass, so that we don't have to do this twice and that we can minimize the costs involved there. These are the owner-related costs that you saw broken out, the $1.28 million. You see a very minimal furniture allowance, about $50,000. That includes cabinets and storage within those classrooms. $30,000 for landscaping, again, addressing the needs of property owners on the abutting property, as well as making sure that we have a playground that looks like a playground when we're done. Significant cost there you will see further down in the next section for the kitchen equipment, $175,000. Again, all of our equipment is original, so we were the ones that might be replaced. Cost to repair that equipment when it breaks down have continued to escalate. And then soft costs, again, permitting costs, bonding costs, engineering costs. But the most significant one that you see there is 7.5% for architectural, structural, mechanical, electrical, and plumbing. That is a negotiated sheet, and that's what it will cost us based on the price. And yes, no allotment there you see for hazardous material because we know enough about that building. It was built in the late 80s, and we're familiar with its history. Junior senior high, again, due to the pieces we've already described, we have about $2.7 million there in site costs, moving the septic line, additional parking, the bus just in the front, $21.1 million in construction costs, just under $3 million in those owner project costs, about $1 million contingency, and again, an allowance for escalation as the new materials will continue to rise over the next couple of years. 2024. Again, the breakdown of construction. You can see the new heavy, medium, medium and light renovations, and some renovations that are the HVAC only. Again, it's not in our best interest to have a boiler if we're not replacing the ventilation units that help circulate the air. An entry canopy there in the front just to provide some rain cover and give you the front entrance that's shown in the photograph or the rendering. It's not actually a photo. You notice playing fields and sewer pump station allowance and the site costs. Those are not included here. Those were things that the facilities committee looked at along the way, and the sewer pump station allowance, fortunately, is not required based on our discussions with Public Works and water treatment folks. And that is good news for us, because that by itself is about $400,000 or $500,000 cost. Again, project-related costs is the owner cost that you saw. We have a larger furniture allowance. Again, right now we're working with some spaces that don't exist. They will require furniture, and we've got some more dated pieces. Lighting for the cafetorium space, as well as music risers and stands for the reconfigured music spaces. Jumping down, you see cost for technology and telephone. Those technology costs have been reduced by what we anticipate as E-rate funding support. So those are federal dollars that help support your technology infrastructure in the school. $100,000 to relocate the portable. At this point, we're projecting that we would move only the larger portable one, the newest one, during the construction phase. And allow for security, again, substantial equipment there to replace our kitchen equipment. It is aged vintage. And again, you can see the largest fee and the soft cost being that 7.5% for architectural, structural, mechanical, electrical, and plumbing fees of 1.8.
Well, how liberal are our escalation, you know, bracket? Is this based on having our bids complete by 2017 or 2018 when we can actually break ground?
So really, most of our bids will happen probably early winter of 2018. They are based on sort of the guidance that our construction management firm is seeing from its associations and its work sort of watching the market in construction mm-hmm. costs. For example, steel costs have escalated considerably and are projected to continue to rise. I don't know that I would say that it's probably conservative.
Okay.
That's also true of our allowances, our contingencies. So we're working with an architectural firm and construction management firm who do the majority of their work in schools. They've renovated a lot of older school facilities. Mm-hmm. They have a pretty good sense of the kinds of things that can come up. And so that 5% that we're carrying in our costs for contingency is based on their expertise in this work in the field.
I think that's actually, it sounds pretty average in comparison to what Raymond was trying to get to go through last year, and it's on the ballot again, and they said it was about a 5% increase.
Yeah.
So,
and their costs have escalated based on their prior.
Yeah, quite a bit. Yeah. Okay.
Go ahead, Blue.
With it being one bond, specifically with the contingencies, at the high school level, I'm a little nervous about it. It should be roughly 10%, not 5.
So
the state kind of says you should go with a 10% contingency. We're not even close. We're way below. But my specific question is there's a contingency for the elementary school. And if that isn't used in that part, can you move? Do they move funds from one to the other to set?
So the
sure.
The legal answer to that question is yes.
Okay.
Voters are approving a total bond at these projected costs. To get back to your contingency allowance, the owner contingency is 5%. There's also a construction management contingency that is also roughly 5%. And so we inherit the architectural, structural, mechanical, electrical fees. We inherit some of the site work. We inherit the permitting or abatement costs. They also inherit some of the costs should we need to tap into contingencies. Those happen
on both sides. So there really is essentially a 10% cost carried.
Sure.
Not to say that we've all seen projects that exceed their contingencies, right? Those things can happen. You can run into something very significant that is unforeseen despite all of the best work of everyone involved. What happens in that situation, there's a building project committee, there's a clerk of the works, there are administrators who are representatives to this team, a facilities director we anticipate at that point, who are meeting weekly to review what's happening. And so at that time, the charge of those folks is to say, gosh, we're projecting a, you know, whatever number it is, overrun. Where can we look at within our project to make adjustments? And that's a team decision. It's not that the construction managers can say, oh, you know, well, we'll just cut back over here and not tell them. It's part of the process.
It just makes me a little nervous at the high school. I look around the room, I think I might be the only one who actually was in the original gymnasium, which is now the library, so I know what's under it. And it's not pretty. It's ugly.
I've been in the crawl space.
Yeah. I'm just hoping that, you know, we've planned ahead for that, because it could come back to bite us. Hopefully it doesn't.
Again, we know that there are some unknowns that we will absolutely run into. And again, based on our work with architects and engineers,
sure,
and construction managers who've worked in schools like Claremont and other older facilities around, we feel that that's a good number.
If I can just add on to that a little bit, fortunately the school district did have a lot of the as-built drawings going way back, you know, to original, the 50s renovation, the 60s renovation, the 80s. Those were extremely valuable. The architects almost cried when they saw them. I mean, they make their job so much easier. They know how things are built. So that's a big thing to know how the building's constructed. They also literally and figuratively crawled all through both of these buildings numerous times and had the benefit of the prior studies that we all know about, you know, over the past 10 to 15 years. So they've been through this. Newmarket's not unique. Banwell just got done. The Claremont High School, which is almost akin to ours. We will find stuff. There will be stuff that you don't expect, just like if anybody's done renovations on their homes that are even 20 years old. You find things you don't expect. But with the roughly 10% total contingency in there, and the common sense notion that Ekman didn't fall off the cabbage truck, they know what they're doing, okay? So there's a patent contingency, and I suspect there's probably a little latent contingency in there too. I mean, on all of those line items you see, they didn't undercut themselves, because the worst thing that could happen to Ekman or Banwell or really any firm in a small state like this is to underbid yourself or to, you know, not have enough left over. The other aspect here is that this is a guaranteed maximum price contract, okay? So although there's some wiggle room for negotiation, if we should find something expensive that needs to be fixed, they can't say, okay, well, we're just not going to put windows in. You know, they can't, you know, it's a rule of reason. And finally, New Hampshire RSAs require public projects over $25,000 to have a performance bond. So this project gets done regardless for the guaranteed maximum price. We hope below, but you know, let's see how it goes. But so it'll be completed.
And I just flipped back to show in the construction. This is the high school renovation, but you can see the fourth lineup is the estimated contingency fee for the construction management firm of 5%. So it's $1 million there as well.
So can I ask, for the guaranteed price contract, can they reduce the scope to offset cost overruns or no?
Reduce the scope. What do you mean by that, Jeff?
Do less or use different finishes or something like that.
That's the rule of reason. They can't sua sponte just say we're going to put in, you know, we were at grade 3 materials, we're going to do 2 now. So that's a decision, you know, that's made by the team.
Yeah, it requires owner approval. Yeah.
Okay, that's what I need. Yeah.
That would be akin to a change order, and they'd have to get our permission for it.
Projected tax impact is shown here. This is based on our current local property tax valuation of $731.7 million. It's a $3.15 per $400,000 projected increase to the tax rate over the balance of those 30 years. The first year actually would start at about $1.33, as you know from your draft warrant article. But we're showing what the long-term impact will be for taxpayers. So again, $3.15 for the median home. The number that's used here in Newmarket is $250,000. That's an increase to local property taxes for that taxpayer of $788. Now, this projection is based on the interest rate projections that we've received from the New Hampshire Municipal Bond Bank. They're projecting for their June-July sale of 2017, when we would go to bond market, that would be 4.25%. So it's based on that still relatively low rate.
Is that the max it would be at that time? Is that what they're basically saying?
That's what they're projecting right now. And I mean, we're hearing across the board, you know, I'm sure you all are hearing that interest rates are projected to increase. Again, the bond bank has some advantages that it pools resources, and they're hearing and projecting 4.25% for a June-July sale. We are continuing to look at we're continuing to look at options for other financing options, one of which, if you've followed meetings, you've heard me mention the U.S. Department of Agriculture Rural Development Program. They have a loan program. Based on the size of our bond, they would cover only about half of it, 55% actually. And we would need to find matching 45%, so it could be, if that program remains available and it's funded through continuing resolution, so it may or may not be, those funds may or may not be available as things move forward at the federal level. But if it is and we're accepted into that, we would anticipate taking 55% from them at a lower interest rate. They're projecting, I think, 3.6, somewhere around there, for a spring sale, and then the balance would be made up. So that number could be lower. Again, it's a best guess at this time, because none of us can be sure what will happen with the interest rates.
So my question is, has the bond term and level debt versus level principal been decided at this point?
So the board had a discussion about that, and nothing's been decided, in that the board essentially has the responsibility to negotiate on the part of taxpayers if and when a bond is approved. But what I heard expressed by the board based on public feedback, and I'll let them speak to that, is that level debt spreads the cost out to taxpayers sort of evenly across the 30-year time period. So current users of the facilities and future users of the facilities will pay the same amount over that 30-year period. A level principal payment would start at a higher rate and decrease over that 30-year period. The initial rate would be about $4 per thousand tax increase, and would, at the end of the 30 years, it drops by about 7 cents a year down to $1.81. What the school board heard from folks who attended our public input sessions was $4 is an awful lot to ask of us. Do it in the most economical way you can. We want to pay the least that we need to pay. But I don't know if any.
I don't know if you can hear me.
Yes.
For what it's worth, economics really was, I think the watchword was affordability. And many folks even used made the comment, make it as affordable as you can, and don't be inclined to make today's residents pay the full freight when we're talking about a 30, 40, 50 year solution. There's no reason why residents, families that are going to appreciate that facility, those facilities, can't contribute some in the latter part of that amortization, that bond, that debt service. So certainly the interest cost on a 30 year is going to be greater than it would be on 25 or 20 or 15 or 10. If you could afford to pay it off in 5, you'd love to, but you know, it's many of us buy our house at 30 and refinance when we find ourselves able, and cut it to a 15. You know, here's the growth path. There are not a lot of us necessarily that can walk into a 15-year mortgage. In this case, we're trying to build in, as we explore, the superintendent and her team have done a great job continuing to explore the flexibilities that could be built into a bonding schedule, so that if the economics of the community were changed, the dollars were available, if we wanted to accelerate our debt service, we could. So they're exploring that. It's harder to do with a bond bank. Easier to do with alternatives, and so we're chasing some of those to see if those are going to be available to us and reasonable, affordable, and attainable.
The USDA has a has a early non-penalty payment provision. The bond, New Hampshire Bond Bank does not. I understand that you can negotiate that, but you're going to pay a higher interest rate. They want their money, their set schedule of, you know, payments, so that's why that is. Another aspect to all of this is that I would hope New Hampshire within the next 30 years would return state aid for building. If that should happen and we get our whatever percent, we can put that, even if we can't prepay, if we can prepay, we could put it towards a prepayment, but if we can't, we could put it into an account and offset taxes.
Raise interest on it, it's like a savings account.
Partially to the same effect, so. And it's anybody's guess as to if and when state aid will come back, and if it does, whether it comes back at a meaningful percentage.
So is that why we landed on the 30-year really more so for the affordability? Because, I mean, looking at 20 and 25-year, I mean, 20-year loan is almost a $250 difference in taxes, even on a level debt. So, I mean, you're talking 900 some odd dollars. I mean, yes, you're talking $8 to $9 million difference in interest on a 30-year loan, but affordability-wise, I think it's a little bit easier on the tax. I mean, when I bought my house, it was a 30-year mortgage, and I refinanced, to your point, Nate, you know, 10 years into a refinance on a much lower and paying it off a lot faster. But in the beginning, we could not have done it had we not done a 30-year loan. Most of the loans that I've watched are 20, 25. I know the last time we sat here 4 years ago, 5 years ago, when we were talking, it was we either had a 20 or 25-year option. So, but we went for the 30 more just for affordability.
Yes.
Okay.
Steve?
Yeah, go ahead, Blue.
How much of, I guess, what is the life cycle that you're thinking of what these two buildings with an Adreno would be?
So Adreno and New were based on when we looked at the New option versus the Adreno option for the junior senior high, we wanted an apples to apples comparison. So both were built on kind of a 30-year at least continued life expectancy. So like we're seeing at the elementary school, the mechanical, electrical, and plumbing at the end of 30 years isn't functional anymore, but we expect that both facilities that's proposed under this bond would last a minimum of 30 years. We're really thinking 30 to 50.
Did that go into play with figuring out whether to do a 20-year or 30-year bond? Is that part of it?
Yes, it did, because you're looking at the long life of the assets themselves, and so when your assets are projected to last that long, financing over that time period is more reasonable than it might be otherwise. Again, like a home
pushing
mortgage.
Daisies up in 30 years, so it doesn't really matter.
Well, I think that's the most important piece to understand in this. I mean, the school costs and all that kind of stuff, I mean, you know, we can sit here and talk about all the one. I mean, Mike, you and your committee did an absolute fantastic job, you know, really vetting this down to what we truly needed versus, I mean, I'm sure there's still people out there that would love a new school, and there's people out there that, you know, still think this is too expensive, but I think this is the most affordable option we have to address all our facility issues. I really do. But I think it's going to come down to the cost, and, you know, the 30-year definitely makes it more palpable, I guess I would say, on the impact versus, I mean, I did the spreadsheets and looked at the math. I mean, and it's substantial difference in tax rates. I mean, if you go a level principal, you're over $1,000 on a $250,000 home, whereas you're only at 700 and something on a 30-year. So it's very different. But you end up paying more in the long run, no different than you would on a house or car. Jeff?
Another question. So I don't think it could be said to impact this tax rate or the budget for this year, but is there any change to the operating costs going forward based on this?
So as you know, we're adding significant additional square footage. At the elementary school, with the exception of the gym, it's largely replacement square footage. We're essentially right-sizing that building. We have the similar square footage in the modulars that we're currently taking care of and maintaining. So, you know, we aren't electrical costs are continuing to increase no matter what. We're upgrading electrical to meet 21st century needs, which largely involve a lot of use of technology. We're going to be paying more for electricity, period. Heating costs at the elementary school, we expect to be relatively neutral because of the increased efficiency. We aren't expecting a huge jump there.
custodial coverage, again, because we're already maintaining those portables, and the addition of a gym really doesn't significantly add to that. Usually it's your bathrooms and your, you know, those kinds of spaces that push your custodial. The junior senior high, on the other hand, we're adding about 50,000 square feet of additional space, and I'm anticipating that we'll need a full-time custodian at some point to keep the level of service to the buildings that we've currently experienced.
And how about the heating there? Was that relatively
Well, again,
neutral?
We're adding 50,000 square feet of new space. So while our overall efficiency is going to increase significantly, we're going from about 70,000 to about 120,000 square feet of space. So our energy costs there will increase somewhat. We expect that the electrical there will also increase somewhat, but we expect some of the energy savings to help offset the custodial costs.
I can't imagine what a new boiler will do for us. Sorry.
Are we switching fuels in the context of this, or are we keeping distillate?
So at this point, oil is what's most readily available to us. Mm-hmm. The committee, through its engineers, took a little bit of a look at alternatives. You can install a two-burner boiler for a negligible difference, so that if at some point you make a decision to switch fuel sources, you'll have the capacity to do that. That's what's currently being discussed.
Okay.
Will we have to increase any faculty at either school?
We're not proposing increases to the program at this point, so it's the existing program. I'm not anticipating a need for additional faculty, again, beyond the custodial position. That's not to say that if enrollment increases by 100 kids, sure, that we're not going to need teachers.
Another question. On the last cycle of school, they stopped repairing the roof at the high school, and it was in phase three, and it was a certain part. I don't know all the details. They were taking care of it, but I think it was almost $700,000. Does that take care of that part? Does that finish? I'm not 100% sure. Does the new addition part of the new roof, or?
Yeah. It's in that new piece.
It'll finally get done.
So it will be addressed. Okay. I think our high school roofs overall were in relatively good shape because we had taken steps to address them over time, but we're addressing the remaining piece there. The gymnasium roof is not being touched, however, aside from the installation of an air handler.
My final question was, and it was an afterthought after you brought it, and I apologize, it was an afterthought. Linked Together actually provides a pretty good program. Have we made accommodations to help them with the phasing of that? Because I know they use the cafeteria at the elementary school. I'm hoping they do. Both my kids
so
went through it.
Mr. Andruski is actually meeting with their board in a couple weeks. Next Thursday, the same night as the school board meeting. That's one of the things I'm sure they're going to ask about. Our goal is to keep, we have summer school programs that we run as well, and our goal is to keep those programs operational, and we'll need to take a look at the best way to do that to meet everybody's needs.
Great. Thank you.
So I have one more question on enrollment. So thank you for the updated projections. Last time I saw the NESDEC projections was from JC time.
Yep.
And they're significantly higher now, but not significantly higher in terms of how it projects in the long run beyond the time frame of the report, but it's not so high that it would be a game changer. How high can the enrollment go in the core spaces and in the classrooms before you'd have to make another addition or some kind of change?
So we're building the junior senior high with a core capacity of 650 and the elementary school with a core capacity of 605 exclusive of preschool. You don't figure preschool numbers typically into your core, so we have some room. That's about 10% beyond sort of the highest level projections that we were looking at.
And that's for the core spaces. How about for the classrooms?
So again, your instructional spaces are built about 10% below that. So whatever those numbers are, 585-ish.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We're just asking that question on a day that they reported that the Hopkinton school is already too small and they have to go back.
I understand.
Yeah.
And you experience that here with the elementary school.
Yeah.
I mean, forecasting enrollment is not an easy thing. There are a lot of variables that go into the mix of that. When we get long-term enrollment projections, I personally don't trust them beyond sort of even 3 years out.
3 years.
And you know, at 5 years and 10 years, they tend to be way off in my experience. Chris, wanted to make sure I had the numbers right here.
So great to have an assistant superintendent.
Any other questions?
I think one of my big concerns is just the overall distractions that are going to be taking place. We hear Claremont a lot, but Claremont's not a good example. I've heard from Claremont students, and they did not have a good experience for a good year and a half. I've been to dozens of high schools on a renovation, and they can often be described as war zones. And I understand that, you know, you're going to have a manager overseeing all this, and the principals will be there, and so on. But, I've got a son that's going to be in high school when all this starts, and it's going to be a big, big distraction. And I don't know how you can get around not having them be distracted and still come in on time and still come in on budget. So I'm just looking for more information there.
I mean, that really is the emphasis of the phasing, right? It's trying to look at how do we minimize disruptions to the educational program with the understanding that we need to be doing work in those areas at times when school is in session. Anne, are you here?
Yes.
Anne has been through that process. Yeah. Come on up. Our high school principals have been through that process. I can tell you about some schools that I visited as well, but Anne probably has a very recent example to share.
So Anne Ellis, member of Facilities Committee, and I was the assistant principal at Forest Middle School through 90% of that addition and renovation. And so for me, having lived through that, and I will have children at both schools through this, that was at the absolute forefront of my mind. And I think that what we have done by looking at both design and phasing carefully, and will continue to do so, is what Burns just said in terms of minimizing it. There will be distractions. Kids will have to move classrooms maybe mid-year. Teachers will have to move classrooms perhaps mid-year. And that is we can't pretend that there won't be any distractions, but I do think that this is a realistic plan, that has been well thought out, and that the benefit of what the kids will have when it's all over will be worth it. And that there's already careful plans of weekly meetings and things in place to make sure that as those things come up, that they are addressed, and that, you know, we're not blasting while SAT testing is going on and things such as that. So coordination between the educational program and the contractors in terms of doing the most disruptive work at the least disruptive time.
So, Greg, can I just add to that,
sure.
If I will? I'm going to have a daughter, as you know, in the junior senior high, as well as a son down at the elementary school. So they're both going to go through this. I worked in construction when I was in college. I know there will be distractions. Of course, there will. Anybody who's been through a renovation of their home or any type of construction at all, even minimal, there's accommodations to be made. But I can also guarantee this: if this proposal doesn't pass, there will be further distraction in the existing building. The kids having to deal with everything we're trying to fix here, you know, year after year after year, and that's been a distraction for what, going on 15 maybe plus years when they originally started to look at that. So when I consider this issue, Craig, if I had my fingers on the button, we could just do a new school and not have that distraction. I think everybody in this room probably would say to do that, and a lot of us were supporting that proposal last time around. But I weigh that against the status quo and what they're having to struggle through now. So,
okay, I would actually want to echo that and say, as we get ready to make this, the concern is very real, and as we move forward with this recommendation, four of your school board members seated today, your superintendent and your assistant superintendent, will all predictably have students that will be in the midst of that project going on. And we appreciate that there will be distraction, but my other point I think that's important is there are distractions even today, because on Saturday morning we're having a conversation in another public setting talking about this very information, and it was interesting to hear another parent share the same story of sitting down for NWEA testing with the drums being banged against, felt like banged against the wall on one side of them, and a special needs student needing some support very loudly on the other side of them in the open air library. because there had to be accommodations made for other students needing small settings and so on and so forth. So we're living with distraction now because of the facilities that we live in. And so as we make that recommendation moving forward, it's not without having debated and discussed all of that because of the personal impact. So thank you for the concern.
I know initially there were some thoughts about being creative with the scheduling. Is that something that you're still considering?
In terms of the school year calendar?
Yeah,
that was
like
the discussion.
Doing away with an April vacation or something along so that line.
That is a possibility. The school board can only approve a calendar 1 year at a time, right. And we're just approving next year's, but that is something we can certainly look at for the following year. Again, we want continuity of teaching and learning, and so we want to think about ways to minimize any disruptions to that, both from a construction vantage point, but also from a break from school vantage point.
They did that at Kingswood pretty actually successfully. My sister happens to teach up there, and they gained 2 years on either end of the school
weeks,
year.
Not years.
Weeks. I wish years, but they gave the kids a lot of homework. So that made all the difference in the world for the construction people, because that they call it the summer slam, where they get most of their work done during. So it's possible.
Yeah. And I think that need is most significant during that second summer at the junior senior high.
How does the, I want to phrase this the right way, so we have an agreement with the construction firm and the architects with a guaranteed maximum price, mm-hmm. and then we have a phasing and a scheduling where we're trying to minimize disruption to the school year and to the programs. How do those two things interact in the sense of, is it possible that in trying to minimize that disruption that the construction firm and the architects are going to say, well, you just voided your maximum price because you told me that I couldn't come in and bang on this wall while class was in session.
Yeah, and I would say good luck in trying to find another job in New Hampshire, you know, as a pragmatic answer, but as a practical answer, it wouldn't happen. Their prices figure that in. It's all part of the analysis that goes in, that you know, that you saw those square footage prices, you know, for different levels of new reno. That's all part of it. It's like how much inconvenience is this? What are the winter costs? What are the construction heating costs? What are the moving costs? You know, where are these things? Are they on the second floor? It's all baked into their number.
Okay. I mean, just the having gone through a few good-sized construction projects in my career, the concern you always get is that the people administering it from the owner's side start to develop a form of Stockholm syndrome where they just want it over so badly mm-hmm. that they begin acquiescing to every request, reasonable or unreasonable, from the construction firm just because they want it to end. Mm-hmm. And then especially if there's an economic hammer tied to that as well.
Yeah.
That's part of the benefit, I would say, of hiring a clerk of the works who mm-hmm. works on behalf of the owners but who isn't caught in the day-to-day. That's their full-time day-to-day. That's what they're there to do. And they're representing us. So yes, is it possible that, you know, on a given day we might suffer some sort of fatigue from, oh, my goodness, we need to move a classroom again? Yes. But at the end of the day, we also have an incredible responsibility to make sure we do this right. We get one shot at it. Mm-hmm. I can tell you, having, you know, run a punch list, like you don't want to miss anything on that punch list. Like all the minor things get listed because that's what you're paying for at the end of the day.
A couple of funny anecdotes. Probably wasn't funny to Portsmouth, but like they forgot the clock in their cafetorium because they were. I don't know if they had a clerk of the works, but man, you may know, but they didn't have a USB port in the front, so they could put a, you know, just little things that they could correct. But that's an important, we haven't really talked about the clerk of the works here. The clerk of the works is a professional building person who works for us. They're an independent eye, you know, they'll be going, they're literally on these projects every day. This is their full-time job. To not only make sure that the things are being built according to the plans and the workmanship is good and the proper materials are good, but they're checking the invoices against all that as well. That's a must on a project like this. And of course we'll have you know, day-to-day oversight with the administration and staff and planning, you know, things. So we know when a test is happening, or an SAT prep, or whatever the event may be, so the construction isn't conflicting. Ekman has a great record in phasing construction. And we've pretty much got the best. And Chris, I don't know if you want to, you know the principal over at SST, correct? And she, you know, has actually worked with Ekman on that project. And they I think the way they described the relationship at the end was one of family. You know, like they still talk to one another. Ekman will still, if they have a, you got to do some commissioning after these things are done to tweak the HVAC and all the systems. They still have that relationship. Ekman's not getting paid anything, but they're helping, you know, so at this point. So I think we're in good hands. But look, construction is a funny thing. You never know. There are things, and so we're not suggesting that this is without ripples as it goes along. Of course it will be.
I will say that, you know, you saw some high-level phasing, right, broken up over summer, school year, anticipated work. What we see on the weekly meeting side is sort of here's the specific breakdown of what rooms are going to be touching and which, you know, ceiling tiles are moving over a, you know, 3 to 4 week span typically at a time. And that's reviewed every week at a project meeting so that if there are concerns on anybody's part, you have the opportunity to identify those and make adjustments along the way. So this overview phasing is just the tip of the iceberg.
Jeff. This all makes me just wonder this question. Like, we've got a contingency in a dollar amount. Have they built in a contingency in terms of time and the phasing? Like, do they have some wiggle room?
Well, the answer is yes, but they will also say it's a tight schedule. And so if there are opportunities to do things like look at the school calendar and are there ways to extend the summer period in that second year, for example, I know that would make our construction management firm happy because they would feel more confident that if those unanticipated things arise, that they're going to be able to finish within, you know, the proposed times.
Would that work with the way that the calendar is generated, if it's generated a year in advance?
Yes.
Okay.
If good short answer.
Thinking about it now.
Yeah, that's the short answer. Yes. But yeah, we're already talking about it.
So as far as the warrant article, I'm assuming this is all pretty much the legal way to write it, because I know it says, you know, interest and all that. It's up to, you know, when are you going to decide on whether it's principal or level debt or level principal? Is that when you actually go out to buy the bonds, or how are you going to do it?
That's correct. I mean, the warrant article authorizes the board to negotiate bonds up to that level of amount, and then it lists a projected tax impact. So if we find out that interest rates have gone down, right, or remain at 3%, and, you know, the 20-year bond then looks really palatable, the board needs the discretion to be able to do that and save the community those interest rates. On the other hand, if it's going up to 5%, it needs to be able to look at, geez, you know, are there any advantages we can get in spreading it out or bonding it in two payments as opposed to one? You know, they have to be able to look at those opportunities. And so we project a tax impact for the first year, which is interest only, of $1.33. And then the second year, when you begin making those principal payments as well, of $3.15. But that will be the board's decision at the time that it's reviewing and bonds are ready to sell. The warrant's been reviewed by Department of Revenue Administration and Bond Council to make sure that all the boxes are checked, and it's pretty much the standard language.
Now, if you end up doing the possibility of what with that 55% through the agriculture, does that doesn't change the language in this warrant or anything like that?
It does not change the language of the warrant, because you're still asking the community essentially to give the board the permission to bond up to that total dollar amount of $38,943,000 plus.
However it means necessary.
And the board by law is the agent designated to do that on behalf of the district.
It's a lot of numbers.
It is a lot of numbers.
Any other questions? Blue, go ahead.
I'm just looking at the tax impact. In year one, between the budget and the
warrant article, it's going to be a $2.31 increase, and then year two, it's $4.13 respectively total. What year are we into the teacher's contract? We had a 2% increase in the budget this year, and we're in year two.
This is year two. Next year.
Is there an increase next year as well, already in it? There is? Yeah. Do you know what it is off the top of your head? I can't remember.
I do not.
Okay. It was two something. I know. Yeah. Okay. I can't have you reach into your crystal ball and
no.
See what kind of increases we may have next year.
No.
It's way far.
You know, we faced this year, as you've heard, some challenges with retirement offsets. You know, but there are a lot of unknowns. The legislature will be establishing a budget and determining the adequacy and all of those pieces. And I wish I could step into a crystal ball, but difficult. School costs are not lessening statewide.
Along those lines, tomorrow, I believe it's at 1:00, although if anybody wants the information, I'd be happy to get it for you. There is a hearing in Concord for full day kindergarten funding, because right now we get funded at half the rate for kindergarten. So there's legislation proposed to fund that fully. So I think it's at 1:00 in Concord. So if anybody wants the information, I'd be happy to send it out.
Anything else?
That's all I have for questions.
So I'll just note, on the screen behind you is just a list of upcoming meetings. The bond and budget hearing is scheduled for this Thursday, with deliberative session on Saturday, February 4th, then voting on Tuesday, March 14th. But there are two additional informational sessions on the bond scheduled for January 26th and February 15th. If members of the public are looking for more information, they can certainly attend those or email me or the facilities committee or school board members, or look at the website that we've put together, which is newmarketschoolprojects.com.
Okay. I think anything we can do to really clarify the tax impact as well as we can, I think that will help our case. Okay. That's all I have. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, everyone, for coming. Okay. So, as far as budget committee, so we have our hearing Thursday at the high school gymnasium, correct? Just want to make sure we have that correct. At 7:00, Craig, you will not.
I will not be.
I will also be out of town. After the hearing, I would request that we vote. If we feel that there's more information after that, what is everybody's schedule next Tuesday if we need to? It's the last day we could do anything anyways. But
I will be out of town next week.
That's what I heard you say, Tuesday through Thursday.
Yeah.
I'll need to check.
I'm hoping we can just do it Thursday night. I'm just putting it out there, but in case anything comes up. But right now, I'd like to at least get the public input and then recommend the warrant article so they can close that up too, because that has to be done by next Tuesday, the 17th. Cool?
So let's just talk about that for a second in terms of making a decision. We'll read the warrant articles. We'll invite public comment only on the two that actually require us to vote, which are the bond and the operating budget. And I mean, my plan at that point, unless somebody suggests something different, is I'm just going to invite a motion to vote, and we'll get a motion, we'll get a second, and at that point, if somebody strongly feels that we should put it off for some reason, that's when I'd like you to speak up. Again, hopefully it won't be necessary, but we want to do this with some semblance of continuity and not look like total morons. So that work for everybody?
You're saying at the conclusion of the public hearing?
At the conclusion of the public hearing.
Yes. Yeah, no, we'll invite public comment separately on the two that we have to vote on, and then I don't want to have public comment, then vote immediately, because that tends to, you know, I liked what you said earlier. Sometimes a little cooling off time is helpful in a situation like that.
Does that work for you if we vote to recommend or not recommend on Thursday? And then that way it's in your warrant articles and all that kind of stuff for the deliberative
right.
session. Okay.
That's great. And if it has to be the 17th.
What would be some reasons to push it off? Like what's potentially what?
Just in case there's any other information that comes out, I just don't want to. I mean, I don't see it being that way. I'm just throwing it out there. Just because last year we had to reschedule and re-vote again because of some of the information.
Can we vote twice?
Yep.
Could we vote
absolutely.
And also mm-hmm. vote Thursday?
I think we should probably hold off till after public comment to vote.
I just wanted to know if it was possible.
We could, but I just think it's. I think it's a better idea to wait for the public comment.
I don't think we can vote before the hearing.
Okay.
But yeah, okay. I mean, the only reason I would foresee wanting to push it off is if something material comes up in the course of the public hearing. Somebody points out, "Hey, you added when you should have subtracted here," and it changes the whole tax rate. Then. At that point, I'd say, yeah, we should probably redo it and vote later, but I'm not expecting that.
Okay. Hmm. All right. So then the only other last thing I have is we have the town budget here that we need to sign. So before you run off tonight, just come. I only need 9 signatures, so 2 of you can play rock, paper, scissors and run. But the rest of us need to sign it so that they have that for the town budget as well. And after that, we have the budget hearing on the 12th, and it's a deliberative session, and it's 10 a.m. that Saturday, correct?
February 4th. Is it 9 for
the town? Is it 9 for the town, 10 for the school, right?
I think so.
Yes.
That is here or at the high
it's
school?
It's at the high school.
High school, okay.
You have to be there. Thursday night's at the high school, right?
Yes.
Correct.
Is anybody other than Dave and Craig not planning to be here Thursday?
That's a good answer.
Yes, that's the answer.
Okay. So if we don't have anything else, do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved. Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Have a good night. See you Thursday. Thursday there.
Good night, everyone. I'll see you soon.
Call in.